the Battle of China. This, the great city of Shanghai on a September day in 1937. This, the fearful beginning of a new kind of war. This, the first mass bombing from the air of a helpless civilian population. Why? Why are these innocent Chinese men, women, children to die beneath the hail of Japanese bombs? To find the answer to this question, we must first understand something about China and Japan. And to understand China, three facts must never be forgotten. China is history. China is land. China is people. Chinese history goes back for more than 4,000 years. That's a long time. It was only 168 years ago that Washington crossed the Delaware. Only 452 years have passed since Columbus discovered America. But more than 4,000 years ago, the Chinese Empire was already in existence. And more important, so was the Chinese civilization, a civilization of art and learning and peace. Yes, China is history. And China is also land, more land than the entire continent of Europe, a third larger than the United States, and rich in raw materials. This vast area consists of China proper and four outer provinces. To the north is Manchuria, huge and desolate, but abounding in raw materials. Next to Manchuria are Mongolia and Xinjiang. Here lies the Gobi Desert, a vast plateau twice the size of Texas, inhabited by nomad tribes who lead their camel caravans back and forth over ancient trade routes. To the west is Tibet, the icy roof of the world, its borders encompassing the eastern end of the Himalayan mountains. Yes, China is land, next to Russia, the largest country in the world. But most important, China is people, 450 million of them. Of every five persons on the face of the earth, one is a Chinese. And since one-fifth of all the human beings in the world are Chinese, we should know what sort of people they are. Well, in all their 4,000 years of continuous history, they have never waged a war of conquest. They're that sort of people. They developed the art of printing from movable type. They invented the mariner's compass, without which no ocean could be crossed. They were among the first astronomers, and their observations of the stars and planets made possible the accurate measuring and recording of time. They are that sort of people. And why do we call our dishes China? Because the Chinese invented the art of making porcelain. And as we all know, they invented gunpowder, not as a weapon of war, but to celebrate their holidays and religious festivals. And it was one of China's great philosophers who, 500 years before the birth of Christ, gave mankind these words: what you do not want done to yourself, do not do to others. They are that sort of people, enriching the world in which we live. Yes, China is incredibly old, incredibly big, incredibly populous. Let's see what China took. You will notice that this is a very old piece of film. Actually, it is more than 30 years old, and it shows a very great man by the name of Sun Yat-sen. In 1911, this man fathered a people's revolution, which brought to an end China's ancient imperial government and began its new era as a modern republic. Winning for himself in Chinese history as secure a place as George Washington has in ours. And he and his followers chose for the cornerstone of their new republic Chinese words that echoed those of another believer in democracy.
Government of the people, by the people, for the people.
实现了三民主义，民有、民治、民享的民主共和国。
国旗是一个国家的代表，国歌是一个国家的形象和精神的象征。现在请全体观众起立，唱国歌。
首先我想介绍欢迎我们的抗战的英雄的贝贝，他今天也来欣赏我们的音乐会，是不是可以请你们站起来给大家看一下。谢谢大家，都 也很感谢所有的乡亲今天来看我们，
谢谢，谢谢大家。同时也很感谢所有的乡亲今天来看我们中山学术所办跟所有的协办单位办的这一场音乐会。经过这将近十个月的练习，他们非常的认真，我也很感谢在座每一位来今天来看我们的成果，我们的工作人员还有我们的团员。办事处齐副处长请你上台，还有我们的侨教中心主任侨委会的也请上台，我们想感谢他们赞助我们。
让我们再一次用热烈的掌声，再一次谢谢吉永堂副处长庄雅淑主任。中华民国对日抗战虽然已经过了漫长的70年，但抗战当时的气氛、悲愤及失去家园的伤痛，相信对许多长辈来说仍是难以忘怀的。
苦难当奔他方，骨肉离散父母丧。长城谣这首歌不仅是控诉敌寇对我国土的蹂躏，更表达了全国人民同心协力结成抗日的新长城。今天我们演唱的版本是由休斯顿知名音乐家萧霁先生所改编的，欢迎指挥江振远先生和钢琴伴奏蔡浩翔先生。 看一段影片，抗战前期描述。
Why is this? Why if the Chinese, who in all their 4,000 years of history have never waged an aggressive war, been forced to fight? To fight and die by the millions. Because China is land. 4 million square miles of it. And because China is people. 450 million of them. And because Japan had a plan to use them both. That plan was finally stated in the Tanaka Memorial. A blueprint for world conquest, formulated in 1927 by Baron Gishi Tanaka, the Japanese foreign minister.
In order to conquer the world, we must first conquer China.
Here was their mad dream. Phase one, the conquest of Manchuria for raw materials. Phase two, the absorption of China for manpower, piece by piece, so as not to arouse the rest of the world. Phase three, a triumphant sweep to the south to seize the riches of the Indies. Phase four, the eastward move to crush the United States. One fact was obvious. China was to be the giant back on which Japan would ride to world conquest, just as Russia was to be enslaved for German use. But how was it possible for Japan, only 1/20th the size of China, and with only 1/6th its population, to think of conquering China, much less the world? There were two main reasons for this. In the first place, modern China, in spite of its age-old history, was like the broken pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, each piece controlled by a different ruler, each with his own private army. In modern terms, China was a country, but not yet a nation, while Japan was a united, well-knit, highly regimented military dictatorship. The second reason lies in the uses each country made of our Western civilization. Let's see what China took. Chinese industry was old-fashioned and inefficient. Transportation was slow and inadequate. But now railroads began to link the great seaports and river harbors with the inland city. A network of highways began to stretch beyond the railroad line, into the deep interior. After leaving them untouched for centuries, China was beginning to use her vast store of raw materials. And soon the tools and machines of the new factories were delivering the goods and products for China's new economy. For the Chinese believed in using the best of Western civilization for the progress of their country. And while they were building this new nation, just a day and a half by steamer across the Yellow Sea, lay Japan. Here, the God Emperor and his fanatic warlords were using this same Western civilization for one purpose and only one: to create one of the world's most powerful war machines. Their aim, the absorption of China and the fulfillment of the Tanaka Memorial.
1925年，国父孙中山先生病逝于北平时，仍念念不忘革命尚未成功，同志仍需努力，希望在最短时间来实现废除不平等条约及国家统一。1926年，蒋介石委员长就任国民革命军总司令，在广州誓师北伐，最后终于完成统一大业。
中华民国抗战初期的策略是：一、用空间换取时间，积极整军精武，以备对日全面抗战；二、利用外交手段来跟日本周旋，岂知国际姑息主义逆流高涨，反而促使日本军国主义气焰更加嚣张。
接下来的三首曲子：玫瑰三月、踏雪寻梅、杜鹃花，都是当时抗战时期的小品。现在让我们来感受当时百姓的心情，欢迎雅乐三重奏。
Thank you.
1937年7月7日，中日战争全面爆发，人们为了逃避战争，被迫离开家乡，东西流浪。现在让我们来欣赏著名声乐家马晓华女士演唱的这首《思乡曲》，伴奏部分由 Miss Robert Nelson 改编。
中日战争全面爆发之前，国民政府仍是派系倾轧，不服中央调度，各自为政。1931年12月，蒋委员长为求稳定政局，为大局着想，于是委曲求全，隐退下野。1936年，因张学良的西安事变和美国驻华将军马歇尔的威迫，使得蒋委员长不得不放弃先安内后攘外的政策，与中国共产党合作抗日。
现在让我们看一段影片，有关游行、逃难、迁徙，来了解一下当年的情景。
That which Sun Yat-sen had dreamed of, that which Chiang Kai-shek had toiled for, that which is stronger than stone walls had at last formed in China, the will to resist.
青年们，有钱的出钱，
好，来打倒日本人，
一定要打回老家去。
In their last bloody blow, the Japanese had accomplished what 4,000 years had failed to bring into being, a united China, an aroused China.
必须要团结一致，消灭日寇，然后我们才能够得到安全。
But the Chinese knew that the will to resist was not by itself enough. They knew that China must develop the power to resist also. And this cannot be created in an instant.So they too made a plan, and it was this. They would slowly yield territory, piece by piece, while they developed the power and built the weapons to rid the land of its invaders. The industrial strength of China must be moved to the west, beyond the mountains, beyond the railroad lines, beyond the lines of communication. There, safe from enemy attacks, they might produce the rifles and guns that China so tragically needed.Thus, China would trade space for time. Space for time. Blow up the roads. Space for time. Scorch the earth. Space for time. Blow up the factory building.Leave nothing for the invaders. And then the people rose and moved, riding, walking, crawling. 30 million of them, spontaneously driven by an epic impulse, rose and made their way westward. The earth teeming with them, moving westward on a trek that stretched through 2,000 miles of roadless wilderness.Thus the world witnessed one of the most amazing spectacles in human history, the greatest mass migration ever recorded. Whatever could be of use and could be moved, the Chinese took with them on a Homeric journey. Their libraries, their schools, their hospitals, all dismantled and carted away. Wherever they could, they gathered along the few remaining railroads, waiting,hoping for some chance to ride part of the way toward their westward goal. And when they had packed the last train with the last ounce of humanity and machinery, the tracks themselves were taken up, rail by rail, tie by tie, to be transported westward, to leave nothing for the enemy. Every river pointing westward was heavy laden.Every sampan, every barge was pressed into service, weighted down to the water's edge with the precious tools for new China. Nothing could stop them, not even the rivers that narrowed into mountain gorges. Westward with their loads of machinery more precious than gold.Measured by the mile, by feet, by inches. The trail they broke was moistened every step of the way by their sweat. Where there were no trains, no boats, no ox carts, there were still willing hands and willing feet and straining backs. 30 million people moving westward, westward from the invader, westward from slavery and death, westward to freedom.
松花江上，微服的故乡， 是抗战初期专为东北同胞而写，叙述东北三省被日军占领后东北居民的苦状和收复失地的盼望。现在让我们来欣赏民声乐家和指挥家黄义明先生对这两首曲子精湛的演绎，钢琴伴奏是邱琼慧女士。
Thank you.
现在让我们来欣赏马小华女士演唱这首《野火》，伴奏陈艺琳。 1937年，中国共产党中国工农红军由国民政府改编为国民革命军第八路军。游击队歌是赫鲁丁当时随八路军整修期间的创作。
出发是抗战初期的作品，但至抗战末期才开始流行。现在让我们来欣赏由男声小组演唱的这两首歌，游击队歌和出发。
我们都是神枪手，每一颗子弹消灭一个敌人。我们都是飞行军，哪怕那山高水又深，在秘密的树林里到处都安排同志们的宿营地。在那高高的山岗上有我们无数的好兄弟，没有吃没有穿，只有那敌人送上钱。没有枪却有炮，敌人给我们造，我们生长在这里，每一寸土地都是我们自己。无论谁要抢占去，我们就和他拼到底。我们都是神枪手，每一颗子弹消灭一个敌人。我们都是飞行军，哪怕那山高水又深，在秘密的树林里到处都安排同志们的宿营地。在那高高的山岗上有我们无数的好兄弟，没有吃没有吃没有穿，没有穿只有那敌人送上钱。没有枪没有枪没有炮，没有炮生长在这里，每一寸土地都是我们自己。无论谁要抢占去，我们就和他拼到底。
枪在我们的肩膀，血在我们的胸膛。我们爱好贵祖国，我们欺负沙场，同一支集中力量，冲冲破了敌人二十里，赶快走了冲力的路上，保定杀生成人的决心，保佑中华民族的荣耀。
自此，国军展开了全面性的抗战，主动攻打上海日军，拉长战线。现在，让我们来看一段影片《军事计划及抗战》。
卢沟桥事变后，日军紧急动员，在不到一个月的时间内，竟能集结10余万众投入战场。 其主要原因是凭借他们有利的地理因素，因为华北紧邻东北，东北紧邻朝鲜，朝鲜一水之隔便是日本本土了。如此，大本营和战场等于已连成一线，掌握了这么便捷的补给支持，任凭中国军队如何不怕死不要命，也难抵挡日军的节节推进。为了扭转这样的困境，除了华北战场以外，蒋中正在遥远的南方上海开辟了第二战场。
因此委员长的战略要如何的使日军的主力他的作战线从北向南的变成由东向西打，我们背对着自己的基地，边打边退，边打边退，这样子的空间来换取的时间才起作用。那么我们主动在中部地区引起另外一个作战。
This time, instead of protesting or negotiating, the Chinese struck back. And not in the north, but at Shanghai, where the Japs least expected it. To understand the fighting that followed, we must know something about the city of Shanghai itself.Situated near the mouth of the Yangtze River, it is the biggest city in China. As the largest seaport in the Far East, it dominated the commerce and foreign trade of China. Within this city of 3.5 million Chinese was another city, the foreign settlement, made up of the French concession and the well-known international settlement. There, the various powers, including Great Britain, the United States, and Japan,had stationed detachments of troops, Japanese, British, French, and our own United States Marines, to assist the police of the Shanghai Municipal Council in the preservation of peace and order, and to protect the boundaries of the international settlement. These detachments were limited in size, but the Japs secretly, and in violation of all treaty agreements,had increased their garrison so that when fighting started on the border of their concession in August of 1937, they thought they were fully prepared for any eventuality. The force of the Chinese counterattack almost drove the Japs into the Wangpu River. Backed up by the heavy guns of their warships, however, the Japs managed to hold out until reinforcements arrived.Now the call to arms sounded throughout New China. And from the vast interior, China's millions answered the call. They came from the south and from the north, from the east and from the west. New soldiers, awkward and unskilled, like all new soldiers. But they toughened and trained. They learned the discipline and order of drill. They knew they must strike and strike hard.They learned to kill. The youth of China also came forward, training to care for the sick and the wounded. Girls joined their husbands, brothers, and sweethearts in uniform.
我是29军大刀队队员。民国20年918事变后，日军完全控制了东北。此后，日军一路南下，到达了河北敦化附近长城上一个重要的关隘 喜风口，与我们二十九军三十七师对峙。由于日军具有武器装备上的绝对优势，致使我军伤亡惨重。二十九军认为，若想取胜，必须以己之长克敌之短，出其不意，以夜袭方式打击敌军后方。于是大家就把注意力放到了二十九军最常使用的特殊装备上，大刀。大刀队因而组成。时间是民国二十二年三月十二日。大刀队注意，今晚有任务出击，马上集合，出发。
心愿无光，只有炮声四野回荡，只有火花到处飞扬。朝天着地，手握刀枪，英勇的弟兄们，紧紧在漆黑的原野上。我们眼观四面，我们耳听八方，无声无息，无声无息，转向敌人心脏。转向敌人心脏，只等那信号一响，杀杀！只等那信号一响，杀杀！我们就展开闪电攻击，打一座轰轰烈烈的胜仗。
大刀向鬼子们的头上砍去！
二十九军的弟兄们，
有！
抗战的一天来到了，
抗战的一天来到了。
前面有东北的义勇军，
后面有全国的老百姓，
咱们二十九军不是俗军，
看住了那敌人，
把他消灭，把他消灭。
大刀向鬼子们的头上砍去，
滚！
抗战的一天来到了，前面有东北的义勇军，后面有全国的老百姓。咱们二十九军不是孤军，看准了敌人，把他消灭，把他消灭，冲啊！刀向鬼子们的头上砍去，杀！
刀向
鬼子们的头上砍去。抗战的一天来到了，抗战的一天来到了。前面有东北的东北的义勇，后面有全国的千万老百姓。二十九军不惧看准的敌人，敌人消灭，消灭，消灭，唰！刀向鬼子们的头上砍去。
一面大劈破风刀，吊手横扫使拦腰，顺风势成扫秋叶，横扫千军敌难逃，跨步挑寥似雷奔，连环提柳下斜削，左右防护平快取，换步移行徒刺刀。
抗战70年周年纪念，我们在抗战期间牺牲了很多军民同胞，在场的今天也有我们抗战参与抗战的英雄们、长辈们，大刀队特别在此向他们致敬，敬礼。预备，加油！滚！起！
大刀向鬼子们的头上砍去！
大刀向鬼子们的头上砍去！
1941年12月9日，日本偷袭美国太平洋海军基地珍珠港。8日，美国对日宣战，中华民国、美、英、苏结成同盟国。
1943年2月18日，蒋夫人、宋美龄女士前往美国国会演讲，成功地说服了美国对华援助，扭转了中日8年抗战的焦灼局势。现在，让我们看一段影片，蒋夫人美国国会演讲。
It is my great pleasure, my high privilege, and my distinguished honor to present to you, Madam Chiang Kai-shek.
Now the prevailing opinion seems to consider the defeat of the Japanese as of relative unimportance, and that Hitler is our first concern. This is not borne out by actual facts, nor is it to the interest of the United Nations as a whole to allow Japan to continue, not only as a vital potential threat,but as a waiting sword of democracy. Let us not forget that during the first 4.5 years of total aggression, China has borne Japan's sadistic fury unaided and alone.
这场以战争与和平为题的演说获得了空前的成功，不但美国各主要报纸纷纷刊登演讲的全文，而且还透过无线电向全美广播。
To those skeptics who sneered at China's magnetic strategy, I should like to ask, what other peoples in the modern world has endured the agonies of war for so long?And so bravely, held so tenaciously, and so staunchly to the defense of principles as the Chinese people. And in the face of such odds in fighting equipment, of these same skeptics, I should also like to ask, given the same conditions,What would they have done? In our position, what could they have done?
American, British, and Chinese forces are gathering strength under Lord Mafat for the liberation of China. For China's war is our war. And now her millions belong not only to United China, but also to the United Nations.According to all the rules, China's position should now be greatly improved. For in her war with Japan, China now had fighting allies. Ourselves, the British, the Dutch, where they are armed and equipped with the most modern American weapons. Trained and hardened to spearhead the coming drive against Japan. In the jungle on either side, American and Chinese patrols protect the road and strike at the Japs.Loaded with artillery, jeeps, ammunition, men and supplies for the armies of China. Over this Burma skyway, over this hump of mountains 16,000 feet high, more tonnage is being flown into China than was ever trucked in over the old Burma road. Young Chinese, many of them trained on the fields of Arizona, New Mexico, California, fly and fight beside their American comrades. The fighters and bombers of the Chinese Air Force and those of General Chennault's 14th Air Force today fly far and wide over China. The oldest and the youngest of the world's great nations, together with the British Commonwealth, fight side by side in the struggle that is as old as China herself.
We in China, like you, want a better world. Not for ourselves alone, but for all mankind. And we must have it.
中国获得了美元物资以及飞虎队的助战，同时也派出远征军去缅甸战场协助英军。当时的中国战场是国军打正面大会战，在沦陷区打游击战。
918事变爆发之后，音乐家黄自有感于神州山河遭敌寇侵略荼毒，特别写抗敌歌，要唤起全国人民抗敌爱国的情操，请听《抗敌歌》。烧的悲愤情绪，以及要求抗战的爱国激情。现在，让我们来继续欣赏《旗振飘飘》。
好了，
1937年8月13日，中日展开了第一次的大型会战，就是震惊中外的淞沪会战。双方血战3个月，死伤超过50万人，一寸山河一寸血的惨烈程度，让国际媒体形容为血肉魔方。
谢晋元团长带领800英勇孤军死守苏州河畔的4行仓库，负责掩护国军50万大军撤退。上海保卫战役彻底粉碎了日军3月亡华的迷梦。请听歌《800壮士》。战，我们有太多可歌可泣的故事可以说，而日军令人发指的战争暴行更是罄竹难书。南京大屠杀、强征慰安妇，
不论是14年的中日战争，还是8年的对日抗战。我们终究是取得了最后的胜利，胜利是牺牲300多万的国军官兵所得到的，胜利是付出死伤3500万平民百姓的代价。现在让我们来看一段日本投降的影片。
1944年10月，中国国民党召开知识青年从军运动会议，会中决定征召10万知青入伍，从此10万青年10万军的运动便在敌前敌后如火如荼地展开。1944年10月31日，魏德迈在重庆接任中国战区参谋长的职务，他说：“我发现国民政府的刚毅与坚韧的抗战精神是惊人的。”这和史迪威以及他的记者朋友所描述的中国不愿作战的报道大异其趣。法国人在德军发动攻势后6个星期就覆亡了，而中国时至1944年却仍在苦撑此去日本发动战争已经7个年头了。中国的悲剧是1941年以前，在没有外援的状况之下艰苦阻击日军，而投入了太大的牺牲。 但这一点美国人并不了解。到珍珠港事变，美国人注意到中国的局势时，当时中国已精疲力尽，蒋中正一直都在四个战场上作战：一，和正面的敌人日本作战；二，和以中国共产党为代表的苏联作战；三，和以军阀及若干半独立省份文武官所代表的离心势力作战；四，和西方帝国主义，尤其是英国作战。后人很难想象，一个落后、贫穷、分裂的国家，在历经七年彻底破坏、死亡、饥饿和恐惧的煎熬以后，一般老百姓的心态将会产生什么样的变化？但承担此一恶果的，却是苦撑八年、精疲力竭的国民政府。抗战后期，来华协助作战的美军已达63000余人，其中大多数为空军以及其地勤人员。美英为了尽速了结对日战争，数度敦促苏联实现诺言，出兵远东向日本施压。但罗斯福与丘吉尔为了寻求战争尽快结束，亦出卖了他们所谓的盟友中华民国。7月26日，由杜鲁门、丘吉尔、蒋介石联合署名发表对日的最后通牒——波茨坦宣言。1945年8月6日早晨8点15分，美国投下了第一颗原子弹，在广岛爆炸。东京8月9日中午，日本最高战争指挥会议人决定接受波茨坦会议决定，宣布投降。同一天，中华民国国民政府主席蒋中正在重庆向国内外全体中国人发表了胜利广播。蒋中正于8月15日致电南京的冈村宁次，指示5项投降原则。1945年9月2日星期天，日本东京湾内群集了包括9艘航空母舰在内的美英大小舰只达380艘之多。中国受降代表徐永昌看在眼里，不禁兴起50年前甲午之役果能一胜，我国海军今日不惜何意的感慨。中国战区受降典礼于1945年9月9日上午9点，在南京陆军总司令部大礼堂举行。9点06分，日本中国派遣军总司令冈村宁次大将，由其参谋长小林浅三郎代表，向中国陆军总司令何应钦将军呈递降书。往后一个多月的时间里，中国在15个受降区分别接受日军投降。直到10月25日，在台北中山堂受降仪式的完毕，中日相持了50年的两度战争到此正式结束。
对日抗战是艰困的。1937年8月14日，剑桥英雄们在大队长高志航的带领下，击落日本6架轰炸机，创下中日空战完胜纪录，打破了日本皇军无敌的神话。打鼓伴奏的是神武峰先生，现在请听永生的814。 杯酒高歌在抗战期间是一首家喻户晓的爱国歌曲，在抗战的大后方被激昂地传唱着。
这是著名的花腔女高音及音乐教育家郎玉秀女士于1941年所录制，当年郎女士只有16岁。请听《杯酒高歌》和《凯旋歌》。军的投降书，自此被割让了50年的台湾，终于回归中华民国的怀抱。 1946年，政府明定10月25日为台湾光复节。现在，让我们一起来唱《台湾光复歌》，歌词在节目表的最后一页。
让人解脱。
我们举办这场音乐会的目的，不仅是为了缅怀先烈，纪念为国牺牲的军民同胞，更是要提醒后辈，战争是可怕与残酷的。对于侵略者，我们可以选择原谅，但是对于历史的教训，我们却不可以选择遗忘。节目的最后，让我们举起手上的国旗，用我们的热情与力量，大声地唱出我们的赞歌《中华民国颂》。
大家一起唱。
来，支持！
有没有请那个抗战的这个老英雄们一起上来，好不好？
请抗战的老英雄。
现在有请抗战的老英雄们一起上台。
非常非常高兴看到这么多的人，大家来一起看这个演唱会，非常非常的开心。最后大家的心情在一副拥护台湾，希望能够台湾能够更进步的情况之下结束，非常非常的高兴，谢谢。
各位观众大家好，我们是大刀队的团员，今天我们很荣幸能够在这里表演大刀队为我们的参战的所有的长辈们来致敬。我们希望我们今天的表演能够提醒世界所有各国家的人要注意和平，不要忘了战争的可怕。
今天我们看到大家这个这种对国家的这种热情啊，我们心里非常高兴啊。
各位美男的观众们大家好，今天真的很感动，大家在纪念抗战70年的音乐会上大风大雨，我们还是做得满满的，我们的节目让每个人都很感动地流下了眼泪。我们希望我们中华民国永远永远一定强。谢谢各位观众。
今年是中华民国对日抗战胜利70周年，也是台湾光复70周年。我们非常感动，我们休斯顿中山学术研究会联合了休斯顿侨界11个侨团，共同举办了这一场的抗战音乐会，借由抗战的爱国歌曲的表演，以及抗战时期的音乐剧的表演，来陈述那一段中华民国对日抗战的一个历史。那在8年抗战当中呢，在中华民国有许多的这个居民同胞，大家英勇抗敌，为了中华民国的存续存亡，大家齐心一致。那我们非常感动，我们的侨胞能够办理这样子的一个音乐会，让我们所有的这个后代的世人能够了解那一段中华民国对日抗战的历史，同时呢能够让大家凝聚在一起，共同来维护自由民主的世界和平。在这边要向所有的这个侨胞致上最高的敬意跟谢意。